up again. So this is where we left off. We were talking about the method of moments and how to actually translate this to a learning algorithm. There's an issue about how you actually estimate the moments that we need. I'm not going to say too much about that. There will be a different algorithm besides the one that I talked about in the first hour. But for now, let's talk about some other models that this technique can be applied to. And I'm just going to talk about a couple of simple models. Two are these very classical Gaussian mixture models and mixtures of linear regressions. And then this other class of models that I call multi-view models, or models with multi-view structure. Okay, so I've already talked about this in the introduction, mixtures of spherical Gaussians. So remember, H is the hidden variable that's discrete, takes on one of k different values. Given the value of H, let's say if it's t, we draw x from a normal distribution with mean mu t and covariance matrix sigma t squared times identity. So these are spherical Gaussians, so that the covariance is just a multiple of the identity. And I'm going to make it even simpler and just say that they're all exactly the same multiple of the identity in this case. Okay, so one way to think about this generative process is that the observation you get is equal to one of the means, y. Y is just one of the different k different means, but then you corrupt it with some noise, with some Gaussian noise. Okay, and so this problem has, learning these kinds of models has been well studied in computer science. And in fact, the method of moments in some sense has been used, even very early on. So these are the first two moments of the Gaussian mixture distribution. So this is the mean of x, this is the second moment matrix of x. Okay. And this is just, you do these calculations straight from very easily from this way of writing down the generative process. Okay. And so just by looking at the second moment, I think Van Paolo and Wong observed that this matrix has this kind of nice structure where this is a, let's say the dimension is much bigger than k. This matrix has this low rank structure, and then it's sort of perturbed by, you know, some multiple of identity. And all this thing is doing is sort of just shifting the eigenvalues of this matrix by some constant. It doesn't change the ordering of the eigenvalues. And so then what they observe is that, well, the eigenvectors, at least the top k eigenvectors, corresponding to the largest eigenvalues, will be vectors that sort of come from this part of the matrix. And that part of the matrix is actually just the column space. The column space of that matrix is just the span of the mu t's, the means of the distribution, or the component distributions. Based on the second moment,
separation in order to get this.
That just doesn't have anything to do with separation. This is even more general. No separation needed here. So they just did PCA. So PCA is something we know. You look at the second moment matrix, you do eigendecomposition, and just project the data now onto the top k eigenvector, the span of the top k eigenvectors. And that subspace will contain all of the mean parameters. Of course, you have to estimate this thing and so on, but okay, let's ignore that issue for now. But separation does come in because the effect of doing this projection is something that improves the separation. Okay, so this is separation issue is something that Chandroy did back in 99. This is a way to quantify how hard it is to learn a particular mixture of Gaussians based on how far the different means are from each other in terms of the number of standard deviations. So one thing that they showed sort of later on with Van Schulman is that even this kind of clustering style algorithms based on looking at distances between points, things like that, so EM can be viewed in that way as well. Will actually, you know, well cluster your data, can cluster your data well, as long as the separation is sort of sufficiently large in terms of the dimension, maybe the fourth root of the dimension. But what Van Paolo and Wong did when they sort of look at the distribution projected down to this k-dimensional subspace that contains the means, suddenly the problem becomes a lower dimensional problem, really just a k-dimensional problem. And effectively, you're just working with a distribution, a mixture of Gaussians in K dimensions rather than D dimensions. So the separation that they need for this kind of distance-based clustering to work is just the, you know, the fourth root of K, which can be potentially much smaller than D, or the fourth root of D. And okay, so but that's just using the second order moment. And in fact, if you use the third order moments, you can actually just completely identify the means within that subspace. And so that's what we're going to show next. Okay. In fact, the separation, so you can completely identify the mixture distribution as long as things are linear independent. The separation could be arbitrarily close to zero. Of course, estimating these moments when these things are arbitrarily close to zero, it's, you know, gets more and more difficult. So this sort of how close, how linear independent you are, or the distribution is, factors into the sample complexity.
And the weights.
The weights also do too. Yeah, the weights should also be bounded away from zero.
No, you can identify those, or you can only on the
effect. You can with the third order moments. But they could be arbitrarily close. There's just no like minimum separation that they had to satisfy. Okay. Of course, I should mention, since this is a computer science crowd, there was a lot of work on mixtures of Gaussians, in particular by Misha and Kaushik, and then Greg, Encore and Greg, looking at mixtures, much more general mixtures of Gaussians without any minimum separation condition. But the type of algorithm that they ended up with either had, you know, some kind of exponential in K complexity, because at least this one, they looked at kth order moments, which are, you know, much more difficult to estimate. Okay, so let me show you how you can use the third order moments. Okay, it's just the same as before. You just need to calculate what the third moment tensor is. So we can write it down like this. This is x is just exactly equal to y plus sigma z, where y is just a random vector that's just equal to one of the k different means. Z is the standard normal. And just because of the fact that the standard normal, the mean of the normal is zero, and the third moment is also zero, you get a lot of zeros sort of appearing. And what you end up with is a lot of cancellation. The third moment of just the y, the random vector y, plus some other tensor. And if you kind of stare at this, really it just involves the expected value of y, because somehow the expected value of zz transpose is just identity matrix in this case. But this is some other tensor. So I'll write it like this. Something that involves the variance and then also the expected value of y, which I'll call mu in this case. In this tensor, the expected value of the third tensor power of y, this is a sort of like a discrete random vector. It just takes on one of k different values. It takes on value mu t with probability pi t. And so then the third moment just looks like that.
So the cancellation of the z's depend on having the same sigma for all the Gaussians, right?
Yeah, so we made this assumption that the different Gaussians have the same variance. We can relax that and just do something slightly more complicated. Okay, so this by itself does not look obviously useful because there's this other tensor here that involves the variance, the sigma squared, and then the grand mean of the data as well. But the point is that the grand mean, of course, you can just estimate directly just by looking at the expected value of x, because z has mean zero. And then it turns out that sigma squared is also something you can directly get from, let's say, the second moment and the first moment. Okay, so then once you can also identify these two things from observable moments, you can basically sort of subtract off that complicated tensor from the third moment tensor of x. And then the difference is just going to be this particular tensor that has the same kind of decomposition that we saw in the previous examples. So just from this tensor, just again, just depends on observable moments of x, the first, second, and third order moments, As long as the means are linearly independent, and of course the mixing weights are positive, you can identify all these parameters. So, for example, then you could use Jenrick's algorithm to recover the parameters from this tensor. Now, of course, to turn it into a learning algorithm, you have to actually estimate the moments. You would hope that you have enough data to estimate them accurately. You'd have to also hope that Jenrick's algorithm even works when things are not exactly the tensor of this form, but we'll talk about that a little bit later.
So if the means are dependent, is it non-identifiable or just not easy to do computationally?
Yes, so I think Misha has an example where there are some kind of, information theoretic barriers in that case, where if they're not linearly independent, you might need lots of data to distinguish between two different mixtures.
Would still be identifiable, but not, they would still be identifiable, just not with a small.
They're identifiable, but they're hard to distinguish. Yeah. But perhaps the parameters are also close in some metric, so maybe you don't care about those cases. Okay, so this was just for mixtures of K Gaussians where K had to be smaller than D in order for these means to be linearly independent. Okay, so that puts an upper bound on the number of means components in the mixture that you could possibly have. Can't have more than D vectors in D-dimensional space that are linearly independent. But there's been a number of works that kind of try to relax this to learn mixtures of many, many more Gaussians. Say so D to, let's say like D squared Gaussians. And basically what they observed is that instead of just using third order moments, you can sort of look at the, say like the sixth order moments, but sort of pretend that, you know, X squared or like, you know, XX transpose is like a vector. And then suddenly, you know, XX transpose, like mu transpose could be, you know, these vectors, mu t transpose. Think of these as vectors in D squared dimensional space. These could be linearly independent. And it's sort of, when it's not linearly independent, that's sort of a rare case. And so they analyzed this thing using something like smooth analysis, and we could show that using sort of similar ideas here with just somewhat higher order moments, let's say instead of third order moments, you look at sixth order moments, then you can identify the Gaussian mixture distributions. So that was for the case where maybe the covariant structure is simple, like spherical or something like that. And then a really nice paper by Ronga, Chiching Huang, and Sham Kakade generalized this to arbitrary unknown covariances. So this is maybe, you know, one people might think of this as kind of the overcomplete case where you have many more components, many more mixture components than you have in dimensions. I think I will quickly go through this next example, which is mixtures of linear regressions, because this is sort of similar to the previous one. But mixtures of linear regressions is sort of another common kind of mixture model where same kind of hidden state. X is now drawn from normal that whose parameters are directly that you can directly estimate. But what's sort of interesting is how the y variable, the response variable, gets generated. It gets generated by, you know, the standard normal model, but the linear regression coefficients are sort of determined by the hidden variable. So if you have data here, this is x and y. Data here might have been generated by two different linear regression lines. Okay, so the story is sort of similar to mixtures of Gaussians, where the second order moments already give you a lot of information. Ignore the details here, but again, what happens is that you have this low rank matrix, and then you add to it some multiple of identity. And then by looking at the second order moments, you can get the span of the linear regression vectors, the beta t's. A nice paper by Sun, Ioannidis, and Montanari generalized this thing to generalized linear models using Stein's identity. So of not just linear regression, but mixtures of logistic regressions and things like that. But this is just using the second order moments. If you look at somewhat higher order moments, a number of people have found that you can identify even the parameters of this kind of mixture of linear regressions model. Okay. And then if you use Stein's identity, you can also extend it to generalized linear models.
Sorry, I didn't get from these GLMs that you're saying, the Montanari, those guys. What is the difference between that and the
GLM? So I've been talking about linear regression, but you can think of mixtures of logistic regressions or Poisson regressions, things like that. But still, like you know, these are linear models where the thing that's important is the linear weight vector. And you have a mixture of these weight vectors. You can at least find a subspace that contains all of these weight vectors. But by looking at somewhat higher order moments, you can exactly identify them. All right, so I'm going to skip this. Just kind of just remind you, okay, just kind of recap. So for mixtures of Gaussians, looking at these sort of second order moments didn't quite identify the parameters of the model, but just going one higher order of moments, you suddenly can identify them as long as they satisfy some kind of linear independence condition. The way these things worked is that you had to exploit, you know, special properties of the Gaussian distribution, you know, things like the Gaussians have odd order moments or zeros and specific values for the other moments. And then looking at these things in a smooth analysis setting, you can kind of generalize this thing to, you know, much richer classes of mixture models. Okay, so maybe sort of the thing to take away from here is that sometimes if you know a lot about the distribution and you know very special properties of these distributions, you can use this to find the moments that are usable for this approach. Let me tell you about now a different kind of structure that you could try to find in your moments, which I call the multi-view structure. So remember the topic model that we had for single topic documents. There was a hidden state called H, which is the topic of the document. The document just had one topic. And then conditional on the hidden state, you draw a bunch of words, IID, from the distribution for the specific to that topic. Okay, and if you're using graphical models, this is maybe what the graphical model looks like, where H is the hidden variable, X1 through XL are the observed words for the document. Now the key property here is that X1 through XL are conditionally independent given H, and that L is more than 3. So each word here provides you some new information about the hidden state, some new piece of information that's important that they're conditionally independent. And so this is what's called the multi-view assumption, that you have multiple views of some hidden underlying state. And this is something that has been studied in machine learning in the past. A famous example is by Blum and Mitchell, where they use a kind of multi-view assumption to justify co-training, semi-supervised learning, and people have also looked at multi-view mixture models. So a multi-view mixture model is one where you're trying to cluster your data, for example, but you have different ways of looking at the data. And so here's an example. Maybe you're looking at news and you have an audio feed for the news. You can also see the video. Maybe there's some captions going on. And given what the news story is, this broadcast news stories is about, you know, what people are saying is completely independent of what the pictures are and what the captions are. Okay, that's the kind of assumption here. But you have different ways to look at them. And these could be, you know, completely different kinds of distributions. Right? They could be, one could be Gaussian, this could be not so Gaussian, and the other one, who knows. Okay. But all that's important here is that conditional on the hidden state, these different views are independent. And what can you say in this case? Well, you can at least say that you are probably interested in the conditional means of these different views. You know, for each cluster, for each component, what is the average sound wave, or what is the average picture, and so on. And also perhaps the mixing weights. So it's already been brought up, but Jenrick's algorithm also generalizes to these kind of asymmetric cases where the different views don't have to be exactly the same. And so in these kinds of models as well, generic algorithm can provide you the decomposition from these third order moments, okay, as long as you know, these various mean components for the different views are linearly independent. Okay, so this is you know, this might seem a little contrived. I sort of made up a story about these different views, but these kinds of this kind of structure kind of appears in a lot of other cases. So if you're thinking about mixtures of product distributions, with mixtures of spherical Gaussians are a special case, these can also be thought of as multi-view mixture models. Hidden Markov models, where there's a hidden state sequence that forms a Markov chain, and the observations only depend on the hidden state at the same time. These can also be thought of as a mixture multi-view model, where H2 is sort of the hidden state, and conditional on H2, the observations you have at X1, X2, and X3 are independent. And this is yet a special case of something even more general called phylogenetic trees. This is the model for describing evolution, and the observed data are just like the genetic material of species in the present day. And the hidden states are the genetic material for ancestor species. This genetic material has sort of mutated according to some Markov process over time. And the hidden state that for which the three different species genetic materials are independent is perhaps the genetic material of the ancestor species that's sort of the least common ancestor for two of the more closely related species. So even in these kinds of very rich generative models for describing phylogeny and other things, you can find this kind of multi-view structure. Okay. Okay, so that's what I'm going to say about these kinds of different types of models where we can apply these tensor decomposition approaches. Okay, so the main takeaways is that there's various kinds of distributional properties that you can exploit. For instance, if you know these kinds of properties, say for a Gaussian, if you can also find multi-view structure, these are also things you can exploit to find the moment that you need for these procedures. Okay, so now I'm finally going to get to the more usable algorithms besides generic algorithm, because as we've been discussing, we never exactly have the moments from the data of the distribution you want, because even if the data was generated from the distribution, you can only estimate them to some finite accuracy. So you really just have an empirical moment tensor, and now all you can hope to do is approximately decompose it to find some to find the components that give you the parameter estimates. So we would like to have some algorithms that can work even if the tensor we have is not exactly does not exactly have this you know this kind of nice form, but it only has it you know it's only close to one that has that form. So then we need some algorithms that are actually error tolerant. Let me describe some of these now. Okay, so. So let's say this is the moment that you care about, the third order moment for some model. And all you have available is not this tensor, but you just have some data drawn from some distribution, let's say IID. Then one thing you could do is to form an empirical estimate, let's say just by looking at the sample average of these xi's, tensor three. And you know by law of large number, this thing will eventually converge to that. At some rate, right? At some, let's say, 1 by root n rate. And it's assumed that maybe like the variance of these things are bounded as well and so on. So you only expect, you know, the tensor that you actually have to be close up to some error and measured in some norm. These are some of the norms that we'll be talking about, a sort of a generalization of the operator norm for matrices to tensors and also a Frobenius norm. Okay, so remember generic algorithm, the way it works. You're supposed to be provided with a tensor that has this kind of decomposition, and this decomposition is, you know, the V's are linearly independent, and you're trying to decompose it into find these different components. Now, of course, we don't have such a tensor with this exact structure. We just have T hat, which is close to T, but only up to some, you know, up to some error. So what we need is that all of these steps that the generic algorithm performs to somehow be error tolerant. Okay, so this doesn't do anything, but we need to compute these two matrices. So hopefully these two matrices, or at least their product of these things, are close to what you would have if you just supply it with T hat. And then you also would hope that the eigenvectors of, you know, of this matrix are close to the eigenvector that you get when you sort of compute this thing with T hat. Now, so this is where things get a little dicey. Okay, so because the stability of all these eigenvectors depends on, you know, the eigenvalues being sort of spaced apart. Okay. So the kind of gaps between the eigenvalues sort of look like this for this particular matrix. So you really need your estimate of that matrix, say right like this, to be close, to be, you know, the difference between them to be smaller than these gaps. Otherwise, you would sort of, you know, change the eigenvalues too much and not clear that your matrix would even be diagonalizable anymore. Okay, so then you can do this kind of analysis. It's a little bit annoying, but ultimately it sort of seems like what you would need is that the tensor to be very, very close, maybe on Frobenius norm, like 1 over polynomial in D, the dimension. So that's maybe, it's still something, it's not sort of arbitrarily bad, but it does imply that the sample size you would need to get this to be, you know, at least some large polynomial in the dimension. So the hope is that we can sort of do better with a different algorithm that doesn't sort of, you know, are not based on these kinds of spacing of eigenvalues. Okay, so that's what we'll talk about in the remainder of this talk. Okay, so the way this works is we're going to reduce to a much nicer case, which is the orthogonal case. And this reduction can be done by considering a different set of moments. Okay. So basically in all of these examples that I talked about, the mixture models, the topic model, I think pretty much all the models I listed on the introduction slides, you have this third order tensor or, you know, some higher order tensor, but there's also a way to get some second order matrix, a second order tensor, a matrix, and that has this kind of a parallel structure. Okay, so the matrix is a PSD matrix, a symmetric PSD matrix, and the components in the matrix are exactly the same ones that appear in the higher order moments. Okay. For example, in topic models, these would be the distribution of word pairs, whereas this is the distribution of word triples. Okay, these are both things you can estimate. Now, what happens is that this matrix here is symmetric in PSD, and it has rank k as long as the v's are linearly independent. And therefore, it determines this kind of inner product, this system, where these components are orthogonal, in fact, orthonormal. Okay. So this is commonly known in machine learning and statistics as whitening. Okay, so you can somehow transform this tensor so that these components now are orthonormal, as long as you also have this matrix. So that's going to be the reduction. And it turns out by using this reduction, we can get algorithms that are very similar structure to algorithms that we use for matrices.
So how do we give the robustness for this part? Because now M is also an estimate, right? So
yeah.
How do we get over that?
Yeah, so you would have to sort of, you know, you would also have to estimate M. And you would have to hope that the whitening operator that you get from the estimate of M to be similar to the whitening operator that you get from M exactly. But this can be done. Okay. All right, so I'm going to reduce it to what seems like a much simpler problem. And the algorithms that we'll get out are actually, I think, a lot nicer than generic's algorithm, although a little bit specialized. Okay, so now let's revise our problem. In fact, I'm going to say D is the same as K now, so I'll just talk about D instead. What do we have now? We have some tensor T hat coming from estimates from our data, such that it's somewhat close to T, where T is a tensor that has the decomposition from before, But now we're going to assume that V1 through VD are an orthonormal basis for RD. Any other assumption that, okay, the lambdas, these multipliers will be positive? So now, if you think about this in the matrix case, it looks very familiar, because if you just kind of reduce this to one order, now you're just thinking about matrices, we have PSD matrices. If there's no error, then we're just talking about the eigendecomposition of a matrix, okay, of a symmetric matrix. This kind of promised decomposition always exists because symmetric matrices always have this kind of decomposition. And the decomposition we know is unique actually if and only if the eigenvalues are distinct. But we already said that, you know, for the third order tensor, there's no such kind of a condition. It's always going to be uniquely determined. But besides that, the other matrix problem that you have is when you don't exactly have that same matrix, but you just have something that's close to it, then you want to know how close are the two different decompositions. Okay, and that's basically the theory of perturbation of eigenvalues and eigenvectors. So in the matrix case is sort of fairly well understood, and we'd like to do the same thing for tensors and actually provide an algorithm that also works to recover or approximately recover the decompositions. Okay, so let's start with the exact case. Let's, kind of, again, pretend there's no noise or no errors, and we have t hat is exactly equal to t, and so the tensor that we have is exactly this one. Okay. So if you just had this, and if you're maybe a machine learning person, you would probably say, let's just try to use optimization here. Okay, and if you maybe write down an optimization problem, the kind of optimization problem you might write down is you want to find a decomposition, okay, that's as close as possible to being exactly the tensor that you observe. So you want to find these vectors and scalars such that when you form the tensor from it, it's as close as possible to the input tensor, let's say in Frobenius norm. Now, not obvious how to do this. It's not clear if this is convex or if it's not convex. But there's a lot of optimization procedures that deal with this, and this is probably maybe in practice what you might try to do first. Okay. What Zhang and Golub said is that you can actually apply a greedy algorithm to this this kind of optimization problem, where you first find, let's say, the best rank one approximation to the tensor. Okay, so you solve what seems like a simpler optimization problem. Just try to find one vector, one scalar, such that the scalar times the tensor product of the vector minus t has small Frobenius norm. And then deflate the tensor, right? Kind of replace t with the rank one component that you found and repeat. Now, usually this is not a good idea because these tensors things the best rank one approximation might not be involved in the best rank k approximation or the best rank b approximation. Because right? This is the little bit weirdness about tensors compared to matrices. So that's not going to be a good idea in general. But for these kinds of special tensors that do have orthogonal decompositions, this actually will work. I should first say that this optimization problem is sort of equivalent, just write it out, to a particular maximization problem where we can kind of ignore the scalar part. So all we're trying to do is trying to find a vector whose trilinear or kind of cubic form determined by the tensor is as large as possible. Okay, but that's the basic idea of the greedy procedure, the greedy approach. And the reason it works is because it's not clear if you can solve this optimization problem either. This is also potentially, it's not convex either. Like, I guess this is not concave necessarily. There are many different local maxima. But it turns out when the tensor does have this orthogonal decomposition, any local maximizer is sort of something interesting for you. Okay. So when this tensor has this orthogonal decomposition, the local maximizers of this form are exactly the various components, V1 through Vk. And the value, of course, is just the same as the corresponding scalar. And a way to see that sort of is, well, can you at least verify that this value takes place, that this value is correct? Because when you plug in one of the VTs, or let's say V1 here, this inner product, because the vectors are orthogonal or orthonormal, will be 1 if and only if t is equal to 1 for when you plug in V1. And so the rest of the terms will be 0. It's also not too hard to show that if you plug in something that's not exactly one of these different basis vectors, you would get a lower value immediately around the one of them. So what could you do? You could just use gradient descent in this case. Okay. You would use gradient descent to find not necessarily the best rank one approximation, but you would at least get one of the components of the decomposition. Okay, so that's basically the procedure. You just use gradient descent to successively solve this rank one approximation problem, and then deflate the tensor so that you can continue and find the next component, and so on. I want to tell you about a slightly different algorithm that's maybe a little bit nicer, but at least gets parameter free. But the main motivation is to compare to what you might have done in the matrix case to find these components. Okay, and this is an algorithm due to, okay, at least we first saw it in this paper by the Lafleur, Damour, and Van de Waal. So it's a fixed point algorithm based on trying to satisfy the first order condition for optimality. Okay, so the first order condition is just that you need the gradient to be, okay, once you take into account the constraints, you need the gradient at x to be equal to some scaling of x. And the gradient is really just some partial evaluation of the tensor as this multilinear form. Some scaling of the tensor, the vector that you get when you sort of partially evaluate this form at x and x. So this is something that you can compute just purely based on the tensor that you have. And what you're hoping for is you can find an x for which this value is equal to just some scaling of x. So this is a fixed point equation that you need to solve. There's an algorithm for doing that, it's just the standard fixed point algorithm, where you just repeatedly plug in your current iterate and set the next iterate to the output, okay, up to some scaling. Now, this should look very familiar because this is just like the tensor version of the matrix power iteration. But it turns out it has very different properties. Okay. So the matrix power iteration, let's say for a matrix, let's say a PSD matrix of this form, where this is the eigendecomposition, the matrix power iteration would look exactly the same. This kind of partial evaluation in the matrix case is just matrix vector multiplication. You just multiply your current iterate by some matrix, by the matrix M, and then normalize. Now, we know that the matrix power iteration, in order for it to converge to, let's say, one of the eigenvectors, usually the top eigenvector, you need some gap between the largest eigenvector and the second largest eigenvector. In other words, you need this particular fraction to be bigger than 0. In order for that to happen, in order for the matrix power iteration to actually converge to the top eigenvector. Now, in the case of the tensor power iteration, there's no gap that's needed. And one way to, this is sort of not so obvious, but we know that the decomposition for the tensor is uniquely determined, even if all of these lambda t things are equal to 1. So even when this kind of gap is 0, the tensor power iteration will converge to one of these components. Yeah.
Is this only in the orthogonal case, or?
In the orthogonal case. I guess the power iteration is not so clear what the power iteration means in the non-orthogonal case. At least why you would use it in that case. But. Okay, so that's just even what can it actually do. These are iterative procedures, so you have to start somewhere. And the matrix version, it will, once you have the gap it will converge to the top eigenvector as long as you're not, the initial vector is not orthogonal to it. It will converge to the top eigenvector. The tensor power iteration is different because where you converge depends on where you initialize. And it's kind of interesting because you can converge potentially to any of these components, V1 through VD. It all completely depends on the initialization. And then finally, in terms of the speed of convergence, the matrix power iteration converges in linear rate, whereas these kind of higher order versions converge at a higher, faster rate, for instance, quadratic rate in this case. Okay, so that's just the comparison to this procedure, and you know, this is not necessarily the procedure that you would actually want to use, but it does have some nice parallels to what we know from standard linear algebra.
So can you steer to which one you want to converge? So let's say...
You mean like set the initial... I mean, if you already knew this, then you...
then so there is no hope, basically, then?
To steer it to... Yeah. So you might have some ideas.
But you don't even know what it is.
Yeah, you don't know, because you don't know these inner products without knowing the components. I mean, there. I'll tell you in a bit that there are, you know, more clever ways to do the initialization. I guess I won't really tell you the details, but there are more clever ways to do the initialization than perhaps randomly or something.
Right. Good.
So it says if V1 x 0 doesn't equal 0, is that going to be only one of them is going to be not equal to 0? Is that? You said it converges to V1 if the inner product
is 0, yeah.
Possible more than one of the VIs as
an inner product? Oh yeah, I mean, in general, if you just picked x0 randomly, in the matrix case, this will be non-zero, but then they will all be non-zero, but you'll still converge to the top eigenvector.
I see.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, so this is all in the case where we have exactly the tensor that has the orthogonal decomposition. I'm also assuming that you sort of run these procedures out to infinity, so there's no like numerical or convergence issues. But of course, in all the applications, we actually do have to care about what happens when there's some error. So you don't exactly have the tensor, the orthogonally decomposable tensor. You just have something that's close to it. And the difference is the error. And you hope that the error is sort of small enough. But since it's sort of based on optimization, it turns out that things are not so bad, right? Because as long as the size of the error in this kind of operator norm is not too large, what you get out in terms of the value, the lambda, the value, and the vector is not going to be too different from one of the components of the decomposition. Okay, so just some epsilons floating around here. It also depends on how large the corresponding scalars are. But that's sort of to be expected.
Just for the case of the cubic tensor, and if you have a higher power tensor, say fourth would be difficult.
Yes. Okay. So fourth is like a little annoying because sometimes you may want to minimize. similar things will hold for higher order tensors as well.
But would you still have the same power of epsilon?
No. Oh yeah. So the I think this stays the same. Yeah. Okay, so you just have to solve the optimization problem now on the tensor that you actually do have. As long as it's close to one that has the right structure that you want, the solution you get out will also be similar. And there's a lot of efficient algorithms for sort of approximately solving this optimization problem, things like the power iteration or some more advanced things, as long as this epsilon here is sort of sufficiently small, maybe like 1 by d or 1 by root d. So this seems like it might be kind of bad because this is the dimension. But remember, the reduction that we've done is that we've reduced this problem to the subspace spanned by the means or spanned by the components. If k, so that really should be thought of as a k in the original problem. So if k is not too large, this is perhaps not too bad. Okay, there's one last kind of issue. This is all about just finding one of the components of the decomposition. But of course, you have to find all of them, maybe k of them, maybe more. And the way we propose to do it with the greedy procedure is to just to do this deflation. Once you found one of the components, you just modify the tensor so that you subtract off the best rank one component and just recurse on the rest. Now, this is potentially a little bit worrisome because you don't exactly find the component. The theorem just tells you that you approximately find one of the components. And so when you do the deflation, you're potentially introducing additional errors into the tensor. Okay, so there already was an error, E. And now when you subtract off the best rank one component, here I'm assuming all the lambdas are one, just to make things simple. When you subtract off the best rank one component, what's actually happening is that you get the correct deflated tensor, you have the original error, and then you have some new error due to the deflation. And if you think about the size of these things, we said that this was a size epsilon. The difference between V1 hat and V1 is also epsilon in Euclidean length. And it turns out then this tensor, at least like in the operator norm, is also of size epsilon. So it seems like maybe you've doubled the error.
Why do you want to do deflation? Because the convergence depends on your initialization. If you randomly initialize it, it will converge to the nearest eigenvector. Mm-hmm. So you do it many times, you will recover all the eigenvectors. You don't need deflation at all.
Yeah, so that's actually fine as long as all of the lambdas are the same. But if the lambdas can be quite different, then you could potentially need to restart many, many times. That's a fair point. If you didn't care about that issue, you could just run the procedure, whatever optimization procedure, you know, d-log d times, you'd be fine. But if you do deflation for various reasons that you care about, it seems potentially worrisome because you might be doubling the error. But this is, again, where this kind of higher order nature of the tensors kind of helps out, because the errors to due to the deflation somehow are sort of lower order effect. Okay, so what sort of matters is the gradient of the form that you get from the error tensor that you introduced, the size of that thing. So if you just plug this in, let's say you pick some direction that's orthogonal to the direction you've already found. Okay, these are sort of the only directions that you should care about at this point. You've already found some approximation to V1. Let's just worry about the other components, the ones that are orthogonal to V1. So if you look at the gradient of the error tensor in those directions, just calculate this out. There's some inner product squared times V1 minus another inner product squared times V1 hat. Since X is orthogonal to V1, this term goes away. And then some Pythagorean theorem thing tells you that, you know, this inner product is at most the square of the distance between V1 and V1 hat, which is the square of epsilon. I put these squares in blue because these are actually important in this case. Somehow the size of the error tensor was epsilon, but now the size of the error tensor that you've introduced, at least in the direction that you care about, is epsilon squared. So it's much, much smaller than epsilon, if epsilon is small. So really the error that you have is sort of remains at 1 plus, say, like a little over 1 times epsilon. So it's always around 1 rather than kind of doubling after each deflation. And something, this is kind of nice because something, the same kind of statement that you would like to make for matrices doesn't actually hold because the squares would just be a 1, and so this thing would just, again, really just be epsilon. Okay, so that's why even if you did deflation, it does not seem so onerous. Okay, so as I mentioned, there are a lot of other algorithms besides this kind of greedy approach to doing the decomposition. Maybe the most popular thing to do would be to do some kind of alternating least squares optimization. The only thing is I don't know if there's quite some, like, a nice analysis of that procedure. It would be nice to have one. Okay, so I've been talking just about orthogonally decomposable tensors, or nearly orthogonally decomposable tensors, and there are some nice, fairly simple algorithms that least you can analyze. There are a lot of algorithms that seem to work well in practice as well, like alternating least squares. I think a lot of the recent interest in these kinds of decomposition problems has been on non-orthogonal tensors or these kinds of overcomplete tensors, And there's a lot of work that's been looking at this lately. And things are very kind of crucially different from the matrix scenario. Okay, so that's all I wanted to say about these algorithms. So let me just wrap up now. So this whole approach of using the method of moments with these tensor decompositions turned out to be quite an effective way to do this kind of parameter estimation in a variety of models. And what was sort of important to make these things plausibly practical was that you only had to consider fairly low order moments. Okay. I mean, so like the means and covariances are the usual ones that we deal with in machine learning, at least. But if you just look a little bit beyond that, like the third order moments or fourth order and so on, a lot of these latent variable models suddenly become, you know, learning them seems a lot very tractable. So there's a lot of properties about these models and the distributions of these models that you had to exploit in order to find the right tensors or the right moments to use in the method of moments. And there's not quite like a general methodology for doing this at this point. Okay, we saw that sometimes you exploit properties of the Gaussian, sometimes you can find this multi-view structure, but in all the a lot of other examples, you find them in much more clever ways. So it's not so clear how to do this systematically. And then there are many algorithms for doing the decomposition. I've just shown you sort of one of them. And this is something that people are actively working on these days. There's a lot of issues that'd be great to resolve. I think maybe the most important one is handling misspecification. So people have mentioned that if you do maximum likelihood estimation, even if the data is not generated from a distribution from the model, it has a nice interpretation. You are minimizing some kind of loss function. We're trying to minimize some kind of loss function that makes some sense to people. It's less clear what is happening with these procedures. Finding parameters that sort of approximately match some moments, that has less of a strong semantics of loss minimization. I already mentioned general methodology. Another thing that's nice about an optimization framework, we know how to incorporate priors or regularization. It's a little bit less clear how you would do that, at least effectively, with the method of moments, but that's something that would be interesting to deal with. And just to connect back to some of the previous bootcamp lectures, these are models where you really do have to believe the data is, you know, could plausibly have been generated from one of the distributions in the model. But you know, this is never really the case, and it'd be nice to be able to incorporate some other feedback or other information, perhaps interactively or through some other channels that could, you know, maybe let you revise the model in some way. Okay, so that's all I wanted to say. If you're interested in reading more, there's a journal paper that we wrote a few years ago that describes a lot of these basics, and that's a nice book chapter by Encore that also describes some of these procedures. Thanks.